morning, will you pray with me? God, we just thank you so much that you are our strength and our hope and our God. And God, we thank you this morning for bringing us, each and every one of us, to this place. And God, we are here to worship and adore you. God, we are here to let your glory fill this place. God, and we just ask that you fill each and every one of our hearts and our minds with that glory and with that peace and with that understanding and with all the many gifts that come from you, so that when we leave here today, those things will overflow from us to others. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen.
Will you tell somebody around you they're in the right place today?
We're in the right place today.
Our first scripture reading is from Luke 13, verses 31 through 35. Some Pharisees came and said to Jesus, "Get away from here, for Herod wants to kill you." He said to them, "Go and tell that fox for me. Listen, I am casting out demons and performing cures today and tomorrow, and on the third day I finish my work. Yet today, tomorrow, and the next day I must be on my way, because it is impossible for a prophet to be killed outside of Jerusalem. Jerusalem, Jerusalem, the city that kills the prophets and stones those who are sent to it. How often I have desired to gather your children together as a hen gathers her brood under her wings, and you were not willing. See, your house is left to you. And I tell you, you will not see me until the time comes when you say, 'Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord.'" This morning's second reading is from the book of Psalms, chapter 27, verses 1 through 7. "The Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom then shall I fear? The Lord is the strength of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid? When evildoers came upon me to eat up my flesh, it was they, my foes and my adversaries, who stumbled and fell. Though an army should encamp against me, yet my heart shall not be afraid. And though war should rise up against me, yet I will put my trust in God. One thing I have asked of the Lord, one thing I seek, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to behold the fair beauty of the Lord and to seek God in the temple. For in the day of trouble, God shall keep me safe in the shelter. God shall hide me in the secrecy of God's dwelling and set me high upon the rock." Hear what the Spirit says today.
Thanks be to God.
You feel Holy Spirit up in this house today. I've been having church all week. I just want you to go ahead and know that. And I told them in the prayer room this morning, my Pentecostal roots have been shining all week long. So if I have a little dancing spell, well, just get up and dance with me. How about that? In our readings today, you found what we English majors love to talk about a lot, similes and metaphors. You know what those things are? Those are comparisons of unlike things. The similes are the ones where you use the words like or as, and the metaphors are the ones where you just say, this is what this is. You see, in the Old Testament, in the Psalm reading, we found that metaphor that said, God is my light. Not God is like a light. God is my light. And God is my salvation. Now I want you to hold on to that, because we're going to come back to it. God is my light, and God is my salvation. Of course, in the New Testament reading, the Luke reading, we found that simile that God is our mama hen that gathers her brood under her wing. Now that's a cool image of God, isn't it? That God is mama, not just father, not just daddy, but God is mama, mama hen. Now, if you've never been around the farm and you've never been around the chicken houses, you may not understand exactly what that looks like and what that's about, but hopefully by the end of this sermon you will understand a little better. In our reading, some of the church folks, called Pharisees, came to Jesus and said, "Herod is coming to to get you. He wants to kill you. Now, if you were here a couple of weeks ago, several weeks ago, you found out that Jesus was up in the pulpit preaching and then sat down. And then once he explained what he had been talking about, they didn't like it too much, and the church folks ran him out of town. Didn't just run him out of the church, ran him out of town, tried to jump him off a cliff and kill him. The church folks. And I said, thank you to this congregation that you have not done that to me yet. You haven't even run me out of the building yet, much less tried to run me out of town or over a cliff and kill me. I know. Get the metaphor. More than once, Jesus' own people ran him away and tried to kill him. And here the church folks come and say, Jesus, Herod is after you. He wants to kill you. Now, I don't know if you realize this, but this is the same Herod that just a few days before had killed Jesus' cousin John. John the Baptizer. Remember the one who baptized Jesus earlier? Had him beheaded because he was out spreading the word of God. He was out preaching the gospel, and he was talking about this Jesus that was king of the Jews. And they put him in prison, and then, of course, through a series of events that we'll save for another day, John ended up getting beheaded. I suspect Jesus had to go attend a funeral, if not conduct a funeral, for his own cousin, the very one who had baptized him that started his ministry. He had to go. And they're the same age, you know, so maybe they were close. So Jesus knew that Herod was good at making threats and carrying them through. And Herod, unlike the church people, probably could make it happen. He could find Jesus. Jesus may not be able to slip from his hands, and he could behead him as well. This was the same Herod who was good at making threats and carrying them out. But we also don't know for sure. One of the commentators that I was reading about this week said they felt like that maybe Herod just felt like Jesus was a nuisance because everywhere he went, he was stirring up trouble. He was stirring up church people. He was finding favor in some people's eyes. You know, when healing comes to your house, you sort of love that doctor, don't you? When somebody raises you from the dead, you kind of love that person who has that kind of authority over life and death. But if you're calling yourself the king of the Jews, or other people have started calling you king, or they have given you a title that somebody else already has, somebody wants my title. We can't have that. So it may be that he really did want to kill him, or it may be that he just wanted to scare him into leaving and going into somebody else's jurisdiction, probably Pilate's, who he dealt with later. Put him out of town, put him into somebody else's legal authority so they can deal with him, and then I don't have to deal with all of this mess. We don't know. But think about what I just said. Whether he was out to kill him or scare him. Have you ever thought about Jesus being scared? I never thought about it until this week. The thought just hit me this week that Jesus may have gotten scared. He absolutely did run away from the crowds when they tried to get him, at least on two occasions when they tried to run him out of town and they tried to grab him and he dashed under their feet and kind of got away from them and went on out of town, went away from them. I don't know. But somehow or another in that moment, I don't know if it was out of fear or out of authority, because how 100% person would have said, that's fearful. The king's after me to kill me. 100% God may have said, I have authority over this. I got this. Don't worry about it. But Jesus was both. So can you imagine the warfare inside of his brain? This, I'm 100% scared, and I'm 100% God, so I have authority over this. Come on now. This same God lives inside of you. Hello? You ever have some of those warfares? I'm scared, but I'm covered with the blood. I'm scared, but the Holy Spirit's inside of me. I'm scared, but I know God's always seen me through before. I wouldn't be here now. Uh-oh. There's that warfare that just keeps going on inside of us. Jesus in that moment said to the church people, you go tell that old fox something for me. A fox. Called the king a fox. Now, this is an ideal metaphor. Not because the fox is so strong. One commentator said, wonder why Jesus didn't pick the lion of Judah or the eagle that could have come down and swooped someone up. Why didn't God choose an elephant or something huge that people might have been afraid of? Instead, Jesus chooses a fox that we, in our time, associate with someone who is sly. Crafty. Someone trying to lay wait and snatch something that doesn't belong to them. Hello? Calls him an old fox. Now, I will tell you, in that day, it didn't just mean sly. It referred to someone who was insignificant. Oh my goodness. You tell that old insignificant one that I said this. I got work to do. He may kill me in 3 days, but today I got some healing to do. Tomorrow I got some people to deliver. I have not finished what I have been sent here to do, so he can't have me until I'm done. Can you imagine standing up to the king? Now, this is not like the king and queens that we have over in England these days that might could get away with saying such a thing. This was where they had people beheaded for not having respect. And Jesus calls him an old fox and says, you tell that fox. Well, it's an interesting choice, that fox, because foxes love to eat chickens. They love eating chickens. I remember my grandparents had a chicken coop. And I'm going to tell you, we like to eat chickens too. And I've seen my grandma go out there and get the old ones, wring their necks out in the yard, and let them run all around without their head or with their head flopping all around until they died. And then she would put it under boiling water and get all the feathers out, and then she'd clean that and cut up that chicken. And we'd have that chicken for dinner. Now, I'm going to tell you, that's a horrible thing to show a child. If you are prone to kill your own chickens, please do not do that in front of your children and your grandchildren. While we thought it was funny at the time to watch them run around without their heads on, when it came time for our rite of passage to have to go kill them ourselves. And then I realized in that one moment it was about me taking the life of something else. And I couldn't do it. It's a scary thing. Don't make your children kill their chickens. Foxes will lay wait at night, and they'll dig under the coop. They'll find a way in that coop, and they'll try for the smaller ones because they don't chew so well. They like to get something they can swallow whole. And they're small. They're not that big. But they try to get something they can swallow whole. But I'm going to tell you, it ain't pretty when they do. A lot of broken bones, a lot of feathers every which way. The hen, the mother hen, that mama I was talking about a while ago, she will fight to the death if she has biddies, if she has chicks, if she had, and I want you to know that you are God's chicks today. It's been a while since some of us have called ourselves chicken, but chicks or chickens, we are God's babies today. We are God's children today. And in that moment that the mother senses her children in danger, she calls the biddies to her, and they run up under her and hide under her wings. And she will protect them even if it kills her. I was reading a story about a fire that happened in an area, and they found a hen lying there in all of the rubble afterwards. And her feathers were all burnt up, and you could tell that she had not survived the fire because everything around it had fired. And the fireman kind of kicked it over, and when he kicked it over, he heard something. He was like, whoa, that chicken cannot be alive. So he went and investigated a little more, and when he pulled that chicken over, even though she had died in that fire, there were all her biddies up under there, alive and well. She may have smoldered in that fire, but she protected those babies. All of them were alive and well. Keep that thought in mind. This idea of Jesus being scared had never occurred to me until I reread this story this week, and I was asking God to give me a new take on it. Because the general take on this, even if you look in your Bible where they have this is where Jesus addresses Jerusalem, and he's woeful about Jerusalem and how Jerusalem has failed. And he's just mourning for them. But because Jesus is 100% human, he could feel fear. And he may have actually been afraid. And that thought just kind of comforted me all of a sudden, that if I get scared, that even Jesus got scared. Even Jesus got scared, so he knows how I'm feeling when I'm afraid. How about you? Have you ever been afraid of something? Have you ever been afraid of someone? Have you ever been so afraid that you thought your life was in danger? Maybe you've had threats on your life. If you've been in MCC years and years and years and years and years, you may have been here in the early years where our churches were being firebombed, where they would have to call off service because they had bomb threats. We had, I can't remember how many churches, there were several of our churches all around the United States that were burnt to the ground. The mother church was burnt to the ground. They had over 1,000 members, had a huge church in downtown Los Angeles. And somebody said, nope, those gay people can't worship. So they burned them out. You know what happened that Sunday? They came and worshiped outside the ruins. They had church, and they said, we won't stop having church. I can guarantee you there were some people there that were afraid, though, that Sunday. Because I think I would have probably gone, but I can't tell you that I wouldn't have been afraid to be standing out there in the open for whomever did not care that we had a place to worship. I want to tell you, I have not often been afraid of situations or particular people. But recently, I had, and those of you that have been around for a while know this about me, I don't remember most of my dreams, if I dream at all. But if I dream about snakes, which is another predator for those chickens, just so you know, because the snakes will get in there, they want the eggs, though. They want the little bitties. They want, you know, they don't want the mother hen. They want the eggs. And they're not as easy to keep out as the fox, even. But if I ever dream about snakes, that is one of God's cautionary dreams for me, to tell me that you have some enemies. Now, they can be spiritual enemies. It doesn't necessarily mean they're human beings. They can be spiritual things, but it's a minute for me to say, Keith, you need to be aware. Now you say, oh, that's an old wives' tale. It may be. I remember my grandmother telling me when I was a small child that when she'd say, you know, the old folks say that if you dream about snakes, you got enemies. And you know what? God took those words, and every time through the years I've dreamed about snakes, it's because there were enemies. There was something out to hurt me or harm me. And in this dream I had several weeks ago, I dreamed about snakes, and they just started falling from the sky. They were just all around me. And I was outside, and my dog was out there, and you know how much I love Miss Maddie. You want to really bring fear to me, you harm my dog. Okay, don't come near my dog. You know, that's my life. But even though they were around her, and they were around me, I reached over, I went over to her and scooped her up in my arms, and I went in the house, and none of them touched either one of us. None of them bit either one of us. We were safe. And I woke up, and I said, God, I don't know what's coming, but I will be aware. I will stay alert. And I started praying. But I'm going to tell you something. Usually those things don't scare me because I've had it happen several times and God warned me and I saw in the vision that none of the snakes harmed my dog or me. So I knew God was in control. But then that human side of me, it started gnawing on me. And then someone said something to me, in fact, wrote something to me that I perceived as a threat on my own life. On my life. I don't mean I want you to get out of town. I mean you're going to be dead. And I've not had that happen before that I can remember, at least not that I took as credible or that I didn't just brush off and move on. But because that was the first thing that happened, When I got that email, I was like, I remembered the dream. There are enemies. There are enemies. And I got scared. I'm going to confess to you. Is it okay if I just confess? You know, I've confessed just about everything. You new folks, I've confessed just about everything that's ever happened to me to this congregation. There's not much about me that people don't know because I'm out there. And I just admit my 100% humanity. Don't laugh because I said I'm out there. They've kept me 7 years. I want to tell you I was afraid. My flesh was afraid. Because I want to tell you, the person that sent me that, I kind of think is either supposed to be on medication and they're not, or they need to be on medication. No offense to that person, because it just, you know, I'm not belittling the person. Don't get me wrong, I'm not doing that. But they are not taking care of themselves. And it scared me because when you start dealing with people who have emotional or mental issues and they're not in control of everything and things are going against them in their own lives, sometimes they harm others because they're in a bad place. You hear me? And this person even told me how easily it could happen. And how some of you could witness it. I did call the police, just so you know. Thank you that we have police officers in our congregation. And I went to the board of directors and shared with them all of the back and forth. And I want to tell you something. I don't know if it was a real threat. The police officer said, it sounds like a threat to me. I want to believe the person was just spouting off at the moment that they were in. But I got scared. I'm just going to tell you. I thought, you know, I'm not quite 54. Is this the end? My mom died at 32 and my dad at 55. Is this the end? I just had a physical. Everything was fine except my cholesterol was a little on the high side. Not huge, just a little. And I'm like, Lord, is this the end of my journey? Because there's nothing like a threat on your life to make you think, is this the end of my journey? And I prayed about it for several days, and I kept reminding myself of that dream. And I kept reminding myself of the end of that dream, that they didn't bite me, and that I was safe. But after several days of not getting any relief, even in my own prayers, I called Carol, my prayer partner in North Carolina. Now, here's the hard part. It was bad enough for me to admit to myself that I was actually afraid at 53 years old. It didn't do good for my ego to think, I am 53 years old and I'm afraid of somebody. But to have to admit it to someone else was even worse. And I called Carol and I said, I need to tell you about something. And I need for you to pray for me because I've been praying for myself for several days and I'm still scared. And she prayed for me and she took authority and she prayed like a good Pentecostal girl would pray. And she spoke life over me. And she spoke away the fear. But I want to tell you something. When she got through praying, I didn't feel any different. But I had to say to her that evening, I said, Carol, I receive the word from you as the word from God. I don't feel any different. I confess, I don't feel any different, but it's not about how I feel. I've just decided I'm going to let God start chipping away at that fear. And I went to bed, and the next morning I got up and I felt that fear again. And I thought, well, I think I'll just stay here at the house today. I'll work from home. There's nowhere I have to go today. And then the thought occurred to me, why, that old sly fox is trying to keep me from doing my work, trying to stop me. Today is a good day to die, and if I die today, there's not a thing in the world I can do to stop it. So I can either sit at home and they can find me dead sitting on the couch covered up, cowered up. Or I can get on about mama's business. I can get on up with mama's business. I can run to mama hen and let her carry me under her wing for a while. I can hide up under there. And if I get out there, because you know the chicks just kind of roam free. But it's when they sense danger, if they're close enough to mama, they can just run right over there. You know what that looks like? Show them what that looks like. Caught him off guard. Show them what that looks like. Look at there. You can't even see them. You can't even sense that they are there. And she's going right on about her business, eating, drinking, but moving them around. Just like that, I thought, God, you can be my mama hen today. I don't have to be afraid. And if I die today, well, then I'll just die today. But I'll die today busy doing what you've called me to do and not cowering under the force of the enemy. And I want to tell you something. That moment of that 100% God and 100% human that Jesus was, that moment, remember that while ago, that battle we were talking about in your head, in Jesus' head, saying, tell that old fox. Tell that old insignificant one, tell that old sly one that would like to come and not only devour the chicks, but like to devour me. That's what Jesus was really saying, to say, I am the mama here, and mama hen's going to look after the chickens. So I will just call all of my children to you. That's why Jesus was wailing over Jerusalem. How often I would love to get you and gather you up under my wing and save you from yourself. Save you from yourself. Jesus is talking to Jerusalem, the holy city, not just of our faith, but several faiths. And say, oh, Jerusalem, somebody needs to save you from yourself, and yet every prophet that comes and tries to straighten you out, you kill them. Jesus knew they were going to kill him too, eventually. But he said, it won't be today. Tell that old fox, I've got some business to do. There's some people that still need to be healed. There's still some people in crisis I need to go pray for. There's still some people upset there that are in the jailhouse that I need to go see or I need to pray for, and I need to let them know, oh, I know you're scared in there, but hang on, mama's here. If you can't run to mama, well, then mama will find you. I want to tell you something right now. I had church when I started thinking about those snakes trying to come and get me, and I want to tell those snakes today, not now, not right now. And if I die today, I just want you to know, I just want you to know, it's been a good day to live.
Amen.
We have to receive what God has for us. We have to receive the protection of God. Decided God was going to be my light and my salvation. Because the rest of that is, whom shall I fear? The Lord's going to be my mama hen. I can go run up under her wing anytime I need to, anytime I want to. Call me scaredy cat if you want to. Call me scaredy bitty if you want to. But there are times that I'm just as human as everybody else. I don't have any more power and authority than you do. But I have that same Jesus living on the inside. That same Jesus that says, come over here. Let me take care of you. We'll run under mama's wing, and she'll take care of us. I want to tell you, I decided today was not just a good day to die. It was a good day to live. I want to tell you, since that morning, I have not been afraid. Amen. I don't know who holds the future other than God. I don't know when it's my time to go. And I don't want you to take on any fears either. But what are you fearing? What are you afraid of? What's gotten you scared in the past? What enemy may come to you and make you scared of your situation. There are people today that are scared of the government. There are people today in our nation that are scared of our president. You'd think we were in a third world country where there was a dictator. It saddens me. It really does. And a lot of them don't even know it. A lot of them don't even know it. Some lady said something that's a friend of mine from college, said something the other day on Facebook, and I was like, can she really believe that? And she was talking about the deceptions and the mark of the beast that was coming, and I was like, oh, dear Jesus, there's a leap. Oh, my goodness. And the very first thing out of my mouth was, she's living in fear. Does she even know it? Because you know, you know, if you just keep filling yourself up with that kind of stuff, if you keep listening. And I'm going to tell you something. I'm going to warn you. You need to be careful what you listen to.
Amen.
You need to be careful what you watch on TV. I've had to turn my channel a few times. You need to be careful what you read and from what slant it's coming. You need to be aware of the foxes. Aware, I'm telling you. Well, maybe. Well, maybe so. Oh, Lord, help us. It's not meant to be political. But I'm going to tell you something. The very reason that lady said that was because my friend sent out a post the other day and said, look what the president is doing. He's just given himself authority to do this. He can shut down the internet. And this is going to be ushering, is deceiving the whole nation who has this kind of authority. And I'm like, okay, has anybody ever been hacked before? If you've been hacked before, you understand why this is a good thing. Because, and anybody ever had their ID, you know, kind of stolen? I've had mine stolen a couple of times. It's not pleasant, and it's irritating and aggravating. And sometimes it's cost me money myself to get things fixed. Like, does this woman have a clue what she's talking about? And then she went off on this long diatribe and started quoting Revelations and how can these people be, how can the whole nation be so deceived? And I'm like, honey, you have been listening to foxes. I'm not talking about just a news program. I'm talking about foxes. You are listening to foxes. I looked it up, and I sent my friend, I said, well, here's the same story from a different slant. Would you read this? And when she read it, she was, now I'm going to tell you, she is not liberal like me, just so you know. But she wrote me a private note after that and said, I can't believe what I just read. How in the world could I have fallen for that? And I thought, yeah. Because you're full of the Spirit. How in the world did you fall for that? It's just foolishness. And if people are on the news all the time trying to conjure up fear, for whatever reason, I'm not just talking about politics, for whatever reason, if it's just to keep the haves in power and the have-nots out of power, come on. If it's just to keep those of us who have had to fight for the same rights as our fellow Americans, we shouldn't have to fight for the same rights. We should not have to be seen as unequal or imbalanced. And yet we have to get up every day with the same blessed fight. And gosh, Lord knows, have mercy. Thank goodness a few people have listened to us and a few things have changed in the last few years. And thank you, Lord, for that. Amen. So that one day we can hopefully all walk together, as Martin Luther King said, hand in hand.
Amen.
All of us, all of us, all of us. Watch what you're listening to. If you're listening to alarmist all the time, I don't care what channel it's on. If you're listening to alarmists all the time, alarmists are here to cause fear. Now, they may be making a lot of money by doing that. And they may feel that what they're doing is really just entertainment, which means that you need to have enough of the Holy Spirit in you to be able to discern what's entertainment and foolishness and what is truth. Amen. And I want to tell you something. You do have the Holy Spirit available to you, and you can discern it if you'll pay attention. But I want to tell you something. I told y'all, I confess this because I used to listen to Fox News all the time and thought it was liberal. I did. I confessed it a few weeks ago. I thought it was liberal because I got my news from Pat Robertson on the 700 Club, because this is a Christian nation and everything should have Jesus written in front of it. I will tell you, that's who I was. But I also, at some point, began to realize that there was a lot of fear being thrown my way. To be alarmed at anything that wasn't just exactly like the fundamentalist church I came up in. Hello? Amen. If it looked different, it must be wrong. Well, that went off in a different direction. That's not where I wanted to go. What I will say to you is this. If you have been afraid, and I want to tell you something, there are a lot of Americans living in fear today that do not have to be in fear. They're choosing every day to let the fox have the power over them. They're choosing every day to let the snake just go all around them, crawl all around them. And all they have to do is step out of it. Step out of it. If they would just do it, and a lot of them don't even know it. They wouldn't even know how to act. If they didn't wake up today in fear, they wouldn't even know how to walk in deliverance. And I just want to tell you, if I can, you can. But I'm going to tell you what, you have to make a conscious choice that even if you don't feel it, just like I said to Carol, even if you don't feel it, I accept your help anyway, God. I accept your help anyway. I accept your help anyway. And I want to tell you something else, too. There are some of you that politically, you and I are on a total opposite extremes. And I'm going to tell you, that lady that was on that email the other day, she was way off the cliff. She was way off. I'm off the other direction totally. She thinks she's right, and I think I'm right. Here's what I want to say, how I appreciate some of you people. Can I use your name? Sparingly. Thank you. Ted and I are probably total opposites in political arena. But you know what? We can go to lunch today. We can sit down, as long as we don't talk about politics. Because I'm his brother and he's my brother and I love him and he loves me, and that's that. We made that up a long time ago, didn't we? When I first came here, he was back there doing what David's doing, and we worked together. We were constantly around each other. And I want to tell you something. We can put all of that aside, our disagreements, and we can laugh and cut up. In fact, a few weeks ago when all of us went to lunch, we laughed and cut up and had the best time. I thought, this is the way it should be. Amen. So just in case you were feeling a little threatened about my references, it's not meant for that. Because we know how to love one another, period, no matter what our political spectrum. Okay? Just want to make sure you understand that before you leave this place. It's not about that. And I've told you, you don't have to agree with me on my political stuff. What I do hope you'll agree with me about is this. The Spirit of God is here and available for all of us. That Jesus may have been afraid. He may have been afraid for his life. You may have been afraid for your life a few times. I'm going to tell you something. The enemy of our soul, that fox, that snake, has got to deal with Mama Hen first. And Mama Hen says, come on over here. come running up under here. I got this. I'm going to take care of you. I will give my very life. And he did. I'd give my very life for you. And he did. He did. I want to leave you with these words. You know, I've fallen in love with the writings of Bishop Stephen Charleston. Hear these words that I believe God spoke through. This is modern Bible. This is the newer Testament. I am here. I am there. Always and at once. So says our God. I am within you. I am around you. I am above and below and beside you. Now and forever. So says our God. There's no place that you can be that I cannot. There is no time that you can inhabit that I will not share. I will be with you. I will watch over you. I will uphold you and enfold you and carry you and lay you down gently. So says our God. Do not fear anything, ever. Do not despair. Do not deny. There is no need, for I am and always will be for you, for all of you. So says our God. Amen.
This is the time in our service where we actually have the opportunity to say, thank you, Jesus, for rescuing me. Where we have the opportunity to give back part of what we've been given to support the ministries of this church. To let go of the fear that, oh, if I give this, how will I pay the rent? Or where will this come from? Or what will I do? Or, you know, if you're a coffee addict like me, how will I go to Starbucks if I give them that $5 today? But, you know, we can let go of all that. We can get rid of that fear. It's kind of funny that as we were passing the front doors of the church next door a while ago, that I would be the one to walk right in front of the door when and hear the woman who was obviously up to take their offering saying, our goal today is $3,000 and nobody's leaving this place until we get that. But that's not the kind of fear we would preach either around here, you know. But it was amusing that it was me that got to hear that because, you know, I'm not scared to talk about it. That's true. It would be perfectly all right. We don't, I'm never afraid to talk about money. And we have been in the hole for a while. So, you know, we do need to crawl up out of that hole as well. And it's up to each and every one of us to reach in our pockets and try to help us move out of that space and move out of those fears. So I hope that God will bless your hearts today or in the future. So that we can all contribute to that. Will you pray with me now? God, we just ask so much that you bless each and every one of us, that you take away our fears, whatever those fears may be. That, God, you take away our fears about money. You take away our fears about money that we can't give it. We take away our fears about money that if the church doesn't have it, what would happen? That, God, you just bless us with abundance in our own personal lives and in our church lives, and that, God, you let us take what's given for your work and stretch that just as far as it can possibly go. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
On the night you were betrayed, took the bread. After giving thanks, you broke it and said, this is my body broken for you. And as you my heart.
the cup. After giving thanks, you lifted it up. This is my blood, poured out for you. And as you drink it, remember me. This is my blood, poured out for you. And as you drink it, remember me. So we thank you for the wine and for the bread. For we see the life you gave, and the blood you shed, and we remember your wondrous love. You gave your body, you shed your blood, and we remember your wondrous love.
Sisters and brothers, at Metropolitan Community Church, we serve in open communion. That means you don't have to be a member of this church or any other church to come to the table of God. All we ask is that you come seeking a new place with God, seeking a way to come to the table and share in the simple elements. What we do is take the bread, dip it in the non-fermented grape juice, place it on your tongue, or if you so choose, cup your hands and we'll place it in your hands and you may serve yourself. There will also be prayer partners on either side if you have a special need that you'd like someone to pray with you about. All that we ask is that you come as the ushers direct you. Would the acolytes and servers please come forward.
In mercy we come to your table. By your grace you are making us faithful. Lord, we remember you, and remembrance leads us to worship, and as we worship you, our worship leads to communion. We respond to your invitation. Respond to your invitation. We remember you.
Yeah.
pray with me. God, thank you for this time we've had together. Thank you, Lord, that even when you were afraid, even when you were afraid, Jesus, that you decided it was a good day to live. It was a good day to keep going about your business and doing what you could instead of cowering somewhere off in a corner. And I'm so glad, God, because you give us the strength and you give us the courage to stand up to our enemies, to our snakes, to our foxes, and that, God, you are our mama hen. Thank you so much for all the many times you've protected us and kept us under your wing. And, Lord, if there's anybody in this place who is facing fear today about anything or they're afraid about anything, that, God, help them to know that all they have to do is run to mama.
Yes.
Just
Amen.
Run to mama today, Amen. And you will take care of them.
Yes.
God, I pray now that you will bless us as we eat wherever we go today. Bless the food to the nourishments of our bodies and our bodies to your service and your divine will. We ask in the name of Jesus our Christ and all that is holy. Yes. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. Shake hands and be friendly.